Okay, well, welcome everybody. My name is Karenza Mansfield, and I'm a health educator and a prevention specialist with the Ledgelight Health District. I also coordinate the Ledger Prevention Coalition. I'm very excited about this morning's presentation, but before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge our community partners that help bring this event to fruition. First of all, I'd like to acknowledge Carolyn Wilson in the back from the Groton Alliance for Substance Abuse Prevention, the New London Community and Campus Coalition, L&M Hospital for their generous donation, and John Davio. Where's John? He's around. Oh, there he is in the back over there, from the Connecticut Association of Prevention Professionals. We are here today with our friends and colleagues from throughout Connecticut to be educated about marijuana and its impact on our youth. Marijuana and public health and how to prevent another big tobacco, latest data and experiences from Colorado and Washington, and legal reform. With strength in numbers, we pulled together our resources to offer this educational forum so that we as prevention professionals, state and local policymakers, as leaders in our communities, we can make informed decisions to effectively guide our prevention efforts. Marijuana policy is a hot topic across the country, especially in our region, with Massachusetts scheduled to vote on recreational marijuana use in just 5 days. People can be very passionate about the topic and may feel strongly one way or the other, and then there's those individuals who are undecided or don't feel their opinions matter. Today, there's a lot of misinformation available and special interest groups that are driving the conversation on marijuana. What message is being sent to our youth? As a prevention professional, I've had the opportunity to speak with our youth in our community, and many of them think there's no harm associated with marijuana use. And as we know, if youth don't think something is harmful, they're more likely to do it. We spent years trying to educate youth about the harmful effects of alcohol and tobacco, and we're just now starting to see our tireless efforts pay off and usage decline. So where are we now with substance abuse prevention? Nationally, we are experiencing an epidemic with prescription drug and heroin. As a result, we've seen the focus shift away from other substances that impact our communities. Recently, I spoke with several people in recovery who support our drug prevention efforts, and many of them revealed that their substance use began in their teens with alcohol and marijuana. This doesn't mean that everyone that uses alcohol or marijuana will graduate to illicit drug use, but it does seem to be a common theme in the personal stories I've heard. When it comes to substance abuse, prevention will always be the key. So now I would like to welcome Dr. Kevin Sabet. We're happy to have Kevin here today. And just a brief bio on Kevin. Dr. Sabet was a consultant advisor to 3 U.S. presidential administrations, an assistant professor. Dr. Sabet has studied, researched, written about, and implemented drug policy for almost 20 years. He has worked in the Clinton administration, Bush administration, and in 2011, he stepped down after serving more than 2 years as a senior advisor to President Obama's drug control director, having been the only drug policy staffer to have ever served as a political appointee in a Democrat and Republican administration. He has appeared since at the Aspen Ideas and New Yorker festivals on the Organization of American States Blue Ribbon Commission advising hemispheric drug policy and in hundreds of forums and discussions promoting the ideas outlined in his first book, Reefer Sanity, 7 Great Myths About Marijuana, which was published by Beaufort. He has also been featured on the front page of the New York Times and in virtually every major media publication and news channel on the subject of drug policy. Currently, Dr. Sabet is the director of the Drug Control Policy Institute at the University of Florida and an assistant professor in the College of Medicine Department of Psychiatry. With Patrick J. Kennedy, he is also the co-founder of Project SAM, Smart Approaches to Marijuana. Welcome, Dr. Sabet.
Thanks, Carenza, and everyone for being here this morning and for hosting me here in Connecticut. It's always great to be here. I don't live that far away, actually, now recently moved to New York, so it's nice to be in a neighborhood, in my neighborhood, so to speak, which, given the amount that I travel, this is definitely considered my neighborhood. It's close by, so it's great. And I appreciate you all being here to talk about this important subject and to have what I think will be a good discussion. If you have questions, just because we're going to be a little tight on time, I think most of you got index cards, so please feel free to fill those out. And then if you didn't get an index card, maybe staffers can bring them around. You can get one, and then we'll avoid duplicative questions and answer questions at the end. But I am happy to be here because I think that this is an issue that is, obviously, we're living in a very important time right now. None of us were around 150 years ago when the last addictive legal drug was commercialized and industrialized, and of course that was tobacco. Tobacco had been used for thousands of years, but all mostly in loose form. Until marketers figured out that if we could prepackage tobacco in what we will call a cigarette, we could market that and we could make a lot of money from it. And that happened about 100 to 120 years ago. Probably we weren't around then. We probably also weren't around 5,000 years ago when alcohol was normalized. Since before the Old Testament, alcohol has been used by the majority of the West. And since at least before ancient Rome, as we know. And obviously, we've been struggling and dealing with alcohol. And of course, in the last 50 years or so, we have moved towards issues related to pills, and specifically opiates, obviously, in the last 20 years, now one of the leading causes of death in this country. So it's interesting that we're now talking about another drug, marijuana, that absolutely has been used for a very long time, probably 2,000 years also, but not used at anywhere near the scale and number as alcohol or tobacco. Maybe some isolated civilizations and some folks used it, but also we're talking about a very different kind of marijuana that was used not just 2,000 years ago, but even 40 years ago, and I'll show you data on that. And so it's very interesting that we're now sitting here 5 days before five states will vote on the full legalization of the use of marijuana. And a lot of people think they're voting on medical or they're voting on decriminalization, which is often totally confused with legalization, even though it's very, very different. In reality, they're really voting for the full-scale commercialization of the sales, production, transportation, delivery, and use of marijuana. So it goes way beyond this idea of adults using it in the privacy of their own home and much more towards a commercial model. This is very, very different than what the Netherlands did 40 years ago. The Netherlands essentially had a policy of non-enforcement. In other words, they have a law on the books because they abide by UN drug laws, which state that drugs actually do need to be illegal. So they sort of abide by it, but they don't follow their own rules, and they've had a de facto legalization there for 40 years. Interestingly, no other European country has emulated that policy. So, for those who say it was a wild success, we're sort of waiting for other countries to agree. Spain and Portugal have a small cannabis club program where if you're part of a private club, you can, sort of underground kind of yes or no, you can sort of go use marijuana, but it's very low level. Nothing to the level of Colorado, and then I would say to a lesser extent, Washington, Oregon, of Columbia, which has a sort of an in-between policy right now. So it's very different what we're doing and the path we're going on. And so, my message today is essentially, I think at the very least, before we make such a rapid policy change, we need to slow down the train, really weigh the pros and cons in a very honest way, and discuss if this is really where we want to go. Because once we go there, we know it's very hard to turn back. Now, alcohol prohibition on many levels, you could argue, didn't work for various reasons, although alcohol use did go down during alcohol prohibition, which is not a known fact, but it did. Overall, alcohol abuse and addiction went way down. But 70% of Americans were drinking at the time, so it was very hard to say we were going to prohibit alcohol. We're talking now about a drug that 9% of Americans use on a monthly basis. What's interesting is that 9% has somehow convinced 52 or 3 or 4% of people that this is a good idea. And so, you know, I think that the support and where we are, because I hear from all the time people saying, Kevin, this is inevitable, right? There's nothing that can be done, and, you know, we're just going to have to do what we can do. The issue is, if 70% or 50%, even 40% of Americans use marijuana regularly, I might agree with that. I might say, you know, you're right. If half of the country's doing it regularly, it's going to be very hard to prohibit it. And so, you know, maybe it should be, you know, we should treat it like something else. But this is something that less than 10% of Americans are doing, even today, where we have had an increase in marijuana use overall. And yet, 50-some percent have bought into the idea that this will pave roads, solve our budgetary problems, get rid of the drug cartels, and, you know, can be regulated successfully. And I think if that shows not to be true, I actually think that support for legalization will swing right back where it was before, and we'll have a pendulum basically going back and forth for the next, I don't know how long. So I look at this from a very long point of view. Although we are very involved, in full disclosure, in the no campaigns across the country, and Tuesday's very important. I also look at this from a very long point of view. I don't think this is won or lost as an issue on Tuesday. Although, of course, the proponents are saying, well, if we win California there, it's over. Everyone's going to follow us, the fifth largest economy in the world, and we're probably going to win California, and, you know, you guys need to go home. I don't quite buy that, because I also think that when it comes to local and city municipality control, you might vote for marijuana to be legal in your state. That's very different than voting for a pot shop in your own community, in your own backyard, a marijuana store selling gummy bears and cookies and candies and sodas laced with THC, secondhand smoke coming out of the place where your kid walks past on their way to school. And so I think this is going to be a consistent pull and push for the next 30 or 40 years. I don't think this is just over on Tuesday. So I wanted to get that out of the way, because it's sort of the elephant in the room is that, you know, I'll tell you, this is probably one of the few states I'm visiting before that is not a voting on this before Tuesday. So it's nice to be kind of away from that madness for a little bit. But certainly I think we need to address it. I did serve in the Obama and Bush, and for very briefly in the Clinton administration in the year 2000. And what I was noticing from the way drug policy discussions were going on is that we were falling into two categories. And the two categories essentially said, all right, you have two choices for policy, especially marijuana. You can either arrest people and put them in prison, which, you know, I see that there's uniform law enforcement, and thank you for your service. I have yet to meet someone in law enforcement who can remember the last time they put someone in prison or jail whose only crime was smoking marijuana. And maybe you gentlemen can be exceptions to the rule, if you can remember. No, you can't. Okay, so he keeps going. But the issue is that the myth out there is that that's all you're doing. That actually this is really, and much of the support comes from the idea that many people, my parents' generation, have from the 60s and 70s, which was, you know, there was a time where, you know, if you had long hair and looked different and smelled of a skunk, you were going to be arrested for marijuana use and you were going to be put in jail. And that did obviously occur. And I'm not saying it didn't occur. I'm also not saying that there aren't disproportionate arrests now, especially if you're a young man of color. There's no doubt about it that you are more likely to be arrested for the same crime than anyone else. That cannot be denied. But that is very different than saying our prisons are full of people who are smoking marijuana, and so our choices are either put people in prison and arrest them for marijuana use or legalize. That's been the choice that America's been presented with. And in these initiatives, if you look at the way that, especially from the yes side actually, the way that this debate is presented, that's how it's presented. And it's presented that way on purpose, because most Americans do not think we should imprison marijuana users. Never mind that we're not doing that. The perception is that we are. So when you ask people, they just say, yeah, no, that's stupid, that we shouldn't do that. And so when people vote for legalization, most of the time that's what they're voting for. You know, the average soccer mom in Denver who voted for legalization 4 years ago, I don't think that they wanted pot gummy bears at the kids' school. No, I mean, they're not going to vote for that. They didn't think that, you know, there would be a massive special interest lobby in Denver lobbying every single state legislator to get, you know, they say they want regulation, but in reality, when these things pass, they want as little regulation as possible. I don't think that the soccer mom in Denver knew that when they cast their vote in favor of what was called Amendment 64. I think what they were voting on was, well, we don't want to put people in prison, and let's fund our schools with this money because people are using it anyway. And absolutely, people are going to use it anyway. I am not here to say that because it's illegal, it doesn't exist, or like no kids use it, or you can't find it. No one's, I don't think anyone is saying that. I think the point is, when we go towards a legal model in this country, that is essentially equal to a commercial model, a marketing model, an advertising model, and a promotion model. And if we want to worry about public health, which is why what many of you all, I know that's what you do, I don't see how we can square wanting to increase public health with a commercial model of legalization, which is exactly the model that that is being pursued right now. So I think this is a false dichotomy. I think that we can have many much better policies that don't fall neatly in either a basket of legalization or, let's say, criminalization. And but that had those really, unfortunately, that's been the way the debate has been discussed. So we started a group. I wrote a book actually right when I left called Reefer Sanity, and it's still on Amazon. Actually, a second edition will be out early next year because I wrote it in 2013. Most of it's still relevant. It was going through these seven myths that we hear about, which I'm going to go through a few of those today. I know I was here, and it's just great to be invited back again about 2 years ago where we went through many of those myths, and I obviously have updates from then. But very briefly about SAM, so when I left the White House, part of the reason I left was I felt like there needed to be a group talking about this a little bit more intelligently. The old just say no tactics probably weren't going to work, especially with millennials and even baby boomers. And instead, we needed something that was science-based, but that really warned against commercialization. But absolutely was open to the proper medicinal use, for example, of components of marijuana that could have promise. We have medicines based on all kinds of dangerous plants, including opium. If we didn't have morphine in this country, we'd have a public health crisis. So morphine comes from opium, right? But we don't ask people to smoke opium to get the effects of morphine. So if marijuana has potential, and I think it does, some aspects of it that have therapeutic purposes, wonderful. We should develop them. And we should have them available, in pharmacies. And I'm not sure if governors or legislators should decide what medicine is, but I think science should. And I think that we should follow the science. And if I'm not sure, by the way, if legislators should decide what medicine is, you can imagine how I feel about voting on medicine on an initiative process by the general public. We're not, I don't think, unless any of us does biomedical research, if someone was to ask us, is the chemical structure 32-645, is that medicine? Well, how can we answer that? We can't answer that. Now, if you had someone in a wheelchair saying chemical 325 really helps me, well, we might be inclined to say, okay, well, if it helps you, we're going to go for it. But then we didn't know that it was actually poisonous, or we didn't know that it was actually, killed half the people, whatever. We're not meant to decide what medicine is. A scientific process is. So we want a scientific process, unfettered, open to research, whether it's marijuana or other drugs, and we want to be able to do that research. And I think that's very, very important. But again, that's very different than voting on medicine. We also want to move away, as is not in the case in the Northeast, it's not as much, but certainly in other states, where you do have an arrest model for marijuana, where there's still time taken up for low-level arrests. Look, we think we can move beyond that through fines, community service, prevention, education, all treatment, all kinds of other things that you can actually do instead of that. But we think that it is a false dichotomy that says we have to either lock up marijuana users or legalize marijuana. So we recruited a scientific board from around the country. And the reason I bring this up is two reasons. One, many people have this idea that if you say anything against marijuana, it's this idea of reefer madness. You're back in the 20s and it's about, scaring people and it's exaggerated. And so they don't really believe a lot of the science that's actually out there on marijuana. They don't want to believe it. And so it was important to have scientific credibility and make sure we had scientists talk about the public health aspect of it. The other reason, it was very interesting, when I went to various scientists and medical organizations, we don't have the medical groups, but the medical groups up there, the response I often got was, Kevin, we've already written on this. The American Medical Association said, Kevin, we did a 350-page monograph on the harms of substance abuse where we included marijuana on pages 26 through 33. and it had 74 references in them. And doesn't the average American read that? And I had to say, well, no, unfortunately not. And then they said, well, but, you know, doesn't the average, you know, 20-year-old, when they want to know about marijuana and mental health, read the Journal of Lancet Psychiatry before they go to bed every night to see what's in there? No, they don't, actually. What do? They Google, is marijuana addictive? They Wikipedia marijuana and mental health. And if you do that, you get hundreds of web pages sponsored by the industry saying that, well, we're not really sure, actually it's not bad, and you know, we've had great experiences. The most popular website that young people look up to look at drug dangers is called erwoid.org. Erwoid is a network of drug users reporting on their positive experiences with drugs. And so if that's where young people are getting their information, then unfortunately the science is not being translated. And you know, I can say this as I'm a PhD, because I mean no disrespect, but as a PhD, we are taught to write articles that maybe 9 people in the world understand. That's what we're taught to do. We're taught to publish in top journals that less than 0.01% of the population have ever heard of, let alone read. And we're sort of meant to do that. We're not meant to write an op-ed in the New York Times or you know, talk to 10,000 people or do a commercial where we reach millions of people for 20 seconds. It's not, and that's okay, because we have other people that can do that. But I felt like we needed to sort of merge these worlds a little bit, because we were losing the PR battle, because the PR battle was being won by the industry saying, you all know that this is fine, they're lying to you. And it would be like if somebody said to a 16-year-old driver, you know that driving 75 on a freeway, it doesn't guarantee you getting into a car accident. You all know people who drive that, and we'd say, well, yeah, we all do, and some of us, not me, by the way, officers, are guilty of doing that sometimes on their way here from New York in traffic. But the issue is, you know, plenty of people drive 75 or 70 and don't get into a car accident. Plenty of people don't wear their seatbelts and will not fly through the windshield if they get into a car crash. And plenty of people, I hate to say it, drink and drive nightly and do not get into any kind of car accident. Now, that's not a reason to say, well, since 40% of people can get away with it, you have good chances. Or in the matter of drunk driving, your chance of getting into a car crash if you're drunk is something like 1 in 300. You know, but we would never, that's not what we would teach a 16-year-old. And say, well, you have a 299 times, you're going to probably be okay. So you're not going to kill anyone. So you're going to be fine. You might get into a little fender bender, but you'll be okay. But for some reason with this issue, we rationalize and say, well, most of the time it's fine, so therefore we shouldn't worry about it. And baby boomers, unfortunately, I think, don't help the situation, because their marijuana use experience was in the 60s and 70s when there was no such thing as a THC gummy bear, right? When there was no such thing as THC waxes that are 98% potent as they are today. When vaporizing the concentrate of marijuana did not really exist. When the average joint was 4% marijuana. And if you wanted a good marijuana joint, you needed to find someone who had recently been to Mexico, because they were going to get you something called sin semilla, which means without seeds. Because the US marijuana had so many seeds and bugs and leaves and twigs that you couldn't separate where the THC was, because mainly you were smoking a twig. And that's true. And so when they sort of say, well, we did it and we're fine, and we know a lot of smart people that have done it and they're fine, this is bringing an experience, an anecdote from the past, and trying to generalize it for now. So, you know, all of that together, all of those experiences, all of the reality of science not reaching most people, has, I think, translated into a very, very confusing issue for people today, and really an issue where the average person just thinks, well, it's really not that bad. Look, we'll say, listen, alcohol seems to be much worse. Well, yeah, most people think alcohol is much worse because 20 times more people drink. So the chances of you knowing an alcoholic are like 200 times more likely than you knowing someone who's a marijuana addict. Not because marijuana addiction isn't real, but because alcohol use is so common. And why is alcohol use common? I would argue because it's commercialized, promoted, normalized. So we're back to that. And so when people say, well, I know plenty of alcoholics who've destroyed their lives, and really the pot user is just kind of whatever, they sort of were late for school occasionally, and they kind of didn't do much, let alone hurt anybody. That's because our experience is, our denominator of who we know is so much greater for alcohol than it is marijuana. But it's a winning line, really. It's a convincing way to talk about this issue to most Americans to say, hey, you and I both know, we know alcoholics that are dangerous. If alcohol is legal, why wouldn't this plant be legal? And that's very compelling. And so we're obviously up against that. But, you know, when we wanted to get the treatment people, not just treatment, but the researchers, they really stepped up and realized this. I like to remind people what the early days of big tobacco looked like, because I feel like we're going through that movie again. Almost 100 years to the day, actually, of the tobacco saga. You know, we had an industry in this country that lied to the American people for a century about the harms of tobacco. They said it was not addictive. They said it was, they didn't think it caused lung cancer, that they were only targeting adults, and it was really only about adults smoking in the privacy of their own home, never mind the green apple cigarettes. That really was, you know, meant for the 55-year-old guy, not the 15-year-old. Trust us. That was for 100 years. And we had advertising, and people think like, well, we wouldn't advertise, Kevin, we can control that. We have no history of controlling that. Has anybody watched primetime TV lately with the pharmaceutical commercials? We're the only country in the world that does that. We're in violation of a treaty that every other country in the world abides by except us. Why? Because we have a powerful industry. They'd lose a lot of money if they couldn't advertise. And it's the same thing with any other industry, any other substance. And so when I see that we used to have Dr. Batty's asthma cigarettes, for example, these were medical cigarettes. And they said, by the way, if you didn't know, tobacco is really good, according to this, for treating foul breath. That's right here. But we do have to give them some credit because they did say it was not recommended for children under 6. That was legal and that was normalized. Our grandparents and great-grandparents lived in that era. And then they said in the 50s, more doctors smoked Camels than any other cigarette. And, you know, viceroys filter the smoke. You know, this is going to be better for you because it's filtered. It's kind of like what we hear today. And you know, as your dentist, I would recommend viceroys. You know, this is not that long ago. I mean, if we had said like, well, look at what they did in the ancient times, those barbarians, folks, this is not that long ago. And when I talk to the average 16-year-old now, they think that this is like Photoshopped. They don't even think this is real. When I ask the average, when I ask really, I hate to say anyone under 30, if they know who the Marlboro Man is, most people don't. If I ask them who Joe Camel is, they say, well, what, Joe Camel, what's that? Well, it's a cartoon character that used to exist that the industry said wasn't targeting kids, but it was a cartoon character to promote cigarettes. That is like, no, what? I mean, that did. And then when I say, if you can actually believe it, smoking was legal in airplanes, they're like, wait a minute. Someone thought it was a good idea, 30,000 feet in the air, in a small metal like capsule with no oxygen as it is, to allow smoking carcinogens. Yeah. A lot of people did, for 100 years, or whatever, 70 years we did. And then, I mean, or that in my high school, and I'm not that old, by the way, I mean, I may be to you, I know, but I'm not that old. Class of 97, high school, okay? There was a smoking patio for high school seniors, 97. And I lived in California where, I mean, you can't even, if we had a non-organic apple, you were in the bad crowd. I mean, it was like you weren't part of the, so, the issue is, this had been permeating our society, and it was only very recently where we turned this around, which is great. And so people could say, well, Kevin, can't we do that for marijuana? Because we haven't made tobacco illegal. Well, the tobacco's legal status wasn't because it's legal that we're all of a sudden thinking it's harmful. No, it was legal forever. We only recently are thinking it's harmful. It's because we had a societal norm after 100 years of painful experience to say, this was a really bad idea, and we do not think this is good. We need to basically move towards restriction. I mean, for tobacco, we're moving towards prohibition. I mean, that's the irony here on the scale. If you were to look at where we're going, we are going towards prohibition of tobacco. I mean, like, you can't smoke in public places. We're increasing the age. We're doing all kinds of things. Whereas it's so ironic to me then for marijuana, we're rolling out the red carpet. It doesn't make any sense, especially when marijuana actually affects your mind in a way that tobacco does not. Tobacco does a lot of bad things, right? It kills your lungs, all the things at the heart, all the things that it does. What it doesn't do, thankfully, is provide intoxication. In other words, you are not high when you're smoking cigarettes. You don't miss work because you forgot about work. You don't drop out of school because you forgot to go to school or forgot to do your homework or forgot where your school was or you don't. Now, not saying anyone should use cigarettes because they're really bad and they kill you and they kill 500,000 people a year. But the idea is that we're talking about another smoke substance which actually intoxicates you and leads to things that we're going to talk about later, like mental health challenges, which cigarettes do not, is something that I just don't understand, that we think that one thing is sort of the worst thing ever. When I ask high schoolers, 95% of them raise their hand when I ask them if tobacco's harmful, if they think tobacco's harmful. When I ask if marijuana's harmful, maybe 25% raise their hand. And another 50% in the audience has some wonderful justification that they read online about why everything I'm saying is a lie and about how this is the greatest thing since sliced bread, which is amazing. It's not like one student. It's like half the class, usually. And that's just very sad to me because it makes me think we are going through what society went through 100 years ago with this. And I agree with Newsweek. They said Big Tobacco is back, and they have a Marlboro man with an e-cigarette. You know, when we look at the vaporization industry with tobacco and marijuana, we are seeing emerging. We are seeing that, look, the tobacco industry isn't stupid. What do they do for a living? They grow a plant, process it, and roll it up. Or they make it into a vapor that you can vaporize. Well, it's the same. That's what marijuana is. It's a plant that's grown that you process. And so we are ignorant if we think that the tobacco industry is simply going to let the, you know, Cheech and Chongs of the world run the marijuana industry, because they're not. And by the way, you're aging yourself when you laugh at Cheech and Chong, because when I, you notice the high schooler is like totally straight face, because no one under 30 knows who Cheech and Chong is either. By the, unless you watch Dancing with the Stars, which I never have in my entire life, but I think one of them was on Dancing with the Stars. But the point is, this is not about Cheech, but it's important because it's not about Cheech and Chong anymore. We sort of laugh at that and, you know, whatever, the stoners that we knew in high school. It's not about them. It's actually about guys that look much more like me with their Yale MBA, and we're in Connecticut, and so it's great that I can say Yale MBA, because it is a Yale MBA, actually, one of them has, with their Harvard law degrees, with their billion-dollar business plans to become the next tobacco executive. That's what their aspiration is. And so if I were to ask you to close your eyes and think about what a drug dealer looks like to you, I highly doubt you would come up with guys that look like this. What is the fastest growing, richest drug dealer today? It's guys like these. And it's not the scary guy on the corner. It's not, you know, it's not any of those preconceived notions. You know, we always like to say that it's like a foreign enemy. Let me tell you, the Mexican drug cartels, when it comes to marijuana, really have nothing on these guys when it comes to production and efficiencies and smart ways to operate a business. These guys are really, like, guys like this are really the best. And that worries me. Because if this was about Cheech and Chong and a joke and your high school or college, like a couple people did it and laughter, okay, we could talk about that. But this doesn't have to do with those guys. This has to do with a very serious effort to become very rich. So I argue that this is not about marijuana. This is not about the war on drugs. This is not about social justice. And actually, we'll talk about social justice a little bit later. This is about money. And if it's about money, you have to hook people as fast as you can. And that's how you actually make your money. Because if you look at, I'm going to skip forward, if you look at the alcohol industry, the alcohol industry makes 75% of the total alcohol consumed in this country is by 10% of people. This is Americans by decile of 10%. 10%, the 10th percentile decile, is responsible for 75% of the consumption. That means if you're in the alcohol industry, you need alcoholics to survive. That's the only way you make money. You don't make money from people who drink wine with their meal four times a week. Couple of beers during the, you know, watching the game on the weekend. No, you make money from heavy drinkers. And you really are only gonna be a heavy drinker if you started drinking young. I mean, that's really, when your brain is developing, that's when addiction starts. The opiate epidemic has proven a small exception to this, but by and large, if you don't touch drugs before 25, you're unlikely ever to do so. And certainly 21 as well. And the alcohol industry knows it. That's why they target college and what they do. That's why we have a lot of products that are aimed towards new drinkers. It's because you have to hook a brain when it's developing and when it's young. And it's also why the taxes for alcohol, the federal excise tax, is 80% of what it was during the Korean War in the early 50s. Because there's a special interest lobby. And I've worked for Republicans and Democrats. And I'll tell you, it doesn't matter who you work for. The revolving door of special interests is great. And these special interests want to make their product as cheap as possible. Because even crack addicts, and this is research has shown this, are susceptible to price. When something is cheap, more people use it. So when it's cheap and plentiful and the availability is wide, you're going to have more users and you're going to have more heavy users. And I think that's a huge, huge issue when it comes to an addictive industry that we have to look for. In this country, marijuana use has been steadily increasing since 2008 among the general population. And what's interesting is that the daily use of marijuana in yellow, alcohol is in red, in yellow, has skyrocketed. So we're talking about 7 to 8 million people admitting that they use marijuana almost every day. See, I really don't care if you're an adult and you smoke marijuana once a month in your basement on a Friday night and you fall asleep. Like, you know, have fun. Good luck to you. You know, and or you try a muffin because it reminds you of the old days of brownies and the law. I don't really care about that, okay? What I care about is the daily, near daily, weekly, heavy user and the brain under 25 that's doing this. Because when I think about a competitive, you know, we're all talking about the number one issue in the presidential election is, you know, jobs and global trade and competitiveness. How we can think we're going to be competitive with China, India, or anyone else if all we're doing is promoting the drug that basically saps your motivation is something I don't understand. Listen, I'm not saying marijuana is heroin. I'm not saying it's opium. I'm not saying it's cocaine or crack or meth. I'm not saying it produces death like this and destroys your family instantly. No. Marijuana is more of what I would call a slow kill. And when I say kill, I don't necessarily mean, you know, dead. But I'm talking about killing your motivation, your drive, I call it the dropout drug. Not only dropping out of school, just dropping out of life. So it may not be the deadly drug like we'd call heroin. But I call it the dropout drug because, and what's so sinister about it is that there's so much denial that there's ever a problem. And so the parent or the young person says, well, at least I'm not doing heroin. I mean, I hear that a lot. And yeah, that's true because heroin can cause immediate cardiac arrest. But on the other hand, this idea that like, well, it's better than alcohol and it's okay. Over the long term, actually, when you look at drinkers and marijuana users, there's no contests in terms of long-term impacts. Self-reported about your success in life, about your want for the drug, your justification for the drug. Marijuana users fare far worse, although I don't like to necessarily think we do well when we start comparing drugs because they are apples and oranges. I mean, if you care about your liver, you shouldn't drink. If you care about other things, your lungs, you shouldn't smoke. So drugs have relative harm that I don't think it's necessarily good to compare, but when people say to me, well, Kevin, if it's legal, maybe more people will drink, and that's better than using marijuana. Well, first of all, alcohol use in Colorado has increased. Sales have increased 4% since they've legalized, so we don't see any substitution. But secondly, that's like telling a young person, why don't you jump out of the fourth floor window? Because we think it's a little safer than the seventh floor window. We don't want them jumping out of either window. The idea that that's the choice doesn't make any sense. The point is, do we want to make something more normalized, accessible, available, cheap, and promoted? That's the issue. Not that if it's illegal, no one will use it. No one's arguing that. We know people will still use it. People will use dish cleaner, if they want to get high. They will use Ajax. I mean, there are a lot of things that they will use. But the point of what legality and illegality does is something related to the availability and the normalization that I think is very, very important. But when I see this increase in daily, near daily use, that is, I think, a big problem. Now, someone would ask, well, why is that a problem, Kevin? Isn't marijuana not addictive? I had a kid the other day say, Kevin, I know marijuana is not addictive. And I said, really, how do you know that? And he was 16. And he said, I know marijuana is not addictive because I can speak from personal experience. I use it every day. No, what does that tell you? And he was saying it with a straight face, actually. It was incredible. The point is that your brain is in rapid development, really from birth to age 30, actually. If we were really going to have an age of consent for anything, smoking, drinking, if a scientific age was, it would be somewhere between 25 and 30. Now, we've settled on 21 because of we just had to negotiate that, actually, with the alcohol lobby because it was 18 forever. And then in the 80s, we said, okay, let's make it 21. That's a negotiation, folks, political. That's not a scientific negotiation, but all right, better than 18. And now for smoking, we're seeing moves. I think in the next 10 years, we're going to see a smoking age to 21 as well, because we know that we have to delay use. And Hawaii has already gone there. California is going to go there very soon. And I think other states are as well. But the point is, this is your brain actually from 5 to 20. That's in the most area of most development. And the reason you make a lot of dumb choices when you're 15, and I am as guilty as anyone is of making dumb choices, is because your gray matter has not been developed in the area of your brain that's really important for judgment and decision making. Now, I wish I knew that when I was 15, because I could have blamed it to my parents and said, well, it's just my brain that hasn't developed. Don't blame me. blame my gray matter not being there. I didn't have the excuse, unfortunately. I wish I did. But the point is, it isn't developed. You do make a lot of dumb choices. But the other thing that this means is that anything that affects your brain during this time, good or bad, has the ability to really alter the development and stick with you much longer than it would if you started to do something when you were 40. So, good and bad, by the way. I mean, learning a second language, do you think it's easier when you're 15 or 5 or when you're 45? Obviously, when you're younger. We learn to swim when we're young. We learn to ride a bike when we're young. You know, we don't say, my parents didn't say, Kevin, bike, it's so dangerous, riding a bike, you're going to be on the... Wait till you're 35 and then pick it up. You know, because then you'll know if a car is coming. You'll be really perceptive and you'll know what's happening. No, we don't do that because it's much harder to learn at 35. Not impossible, but much harder. The same thing is true, I should say, for drugs or obviously alcohol is included. If you start when you're younger, it has the ability to affect your brain much more acutely than if you started when you were older. Because when you're older, those parts of the brain are already developed and they're not as susceptible. Doesn't mean you can't get addicted. Of course you can. And a lot of people pick up very bad habits in their 40s, 50s, and 60s. But it's much easier to pick up those habits in your teens and 20s and much harder to shake them if you've begun them in your teens and 20s because you're essentially training your brain to be used to this and to know what this is and to want it. And addiction is simply, it happens right here in the center cortex of the brain. Reward and memory is really what we're talking about. That's the addiction center of the brain, reward and memory. Your brain gets a reward from drinking, from using drugs. It gets a high, the endorphins flush in. It's like, wow. And your memory says, boy, that felt good. I'm going to remember that tomorrow. And I'm going to ask you to do it again tomorrow because I want to feel that again. That is the truth for all kinds of things, by the way. I mean, eating, sex, all kinds of things. The thing about eating, sex, and other natural highs, like winning a trophy or playing a sport, is that the level of a high is on a natural level that you get when you do those things. Most people are in a range of various things, depending on what you like better or what your preferences are. When it comes to things like drugs, it's an external force, and the high actually, unfortunately, is much greater than those natural highs. In other words, the feeling of heroin abuse, of marijuana, of all kinds of things, can feel a lot better than doing well in school and how you feel when you get an A or eating something that you like or whatever. And so for a lot of people, that high is so powerful, that memory and reward is so strong that that's where the addiction comes in. And marijuana, THC, binds to these receptors. You have receptors all over your brain and all over your body, and you have all kinds of receptors, including opiate receptors, but you have THC, you have what we would call THC receptors, to just make a long story short. And that means that when you ingest THC, which is the active ingredient in marijuana, that's what gets you high. Remember, marijuana is hundreds of components. THC is one of those things. THC gets you high. It binds to these various receptors, and so that's why your coordination gets a little messed up, your vision, your sensation, your movement, your judgment, and your rewarded memory. All of those things are affected by THC. Interestingly, by the way, if you were to look at a brain on opiates, you would see different regions lit up, but the other region you would see lit up is the brainstem. And the reason that's so dangerous is because the brainstem is what controls breathing and your heart. And so why do you have fatal overdoses with opiates? Because your brainstem has a lot of opiate receptors. That's what makes that so dangerous. And then you combine it with benzodiazepines, and that is when the brainstem gives up. And that's what we call a fatal overdose or a near fatal overdose. With marijuana, you get overdose. You absolutely get the extreme panic attack, the psychotic episode. If you thought that the THC cookie wasn't a THC cookie and you ate it, your brain was certainly not prepared for it. You've never done it before. That makes you susceptible to all those overdoses. But it's very rare to have a fatal overdose with that because you don't have those receptors in the brainstem. And so I get a lot of people saying, Kevin, at least it doesn't kill you. Well, it doesn't kill you in terms of a fatal overdose because you don't have receptors. But obviously we know thousands of families impacted from drugged driving, from accidents other than driving where they actually do, or from suicide. And though that would be, in my mind, an indirect way, marijuana does kill you. But again, more importantly, I think marijuana affects you in these many, many different ways that are more subtle, that aren't as dramatic as an overdose death like with opiates. And so that subtlety sometimes, again, makes it difficult to sort of talk about the issue. Now, I just wanted to show this. As I was talking earlier, the THC level in modern marijuana, the average joint. Now, most people are moving away from smoking joints. So take this with a grain of salt, but the average joint in Woodstock era was 3%, 2%. Now we're talking about 12, 14, 15%. But more than just a joint, the way that a lot of people, especially young people, are now moving to marijuana is not marijuana, but actually THC concentrates. And so when people say marijuana, I wish we had a different name, because marijuana or cannabis, really, that's what people remember from 40 years ago. That's the joint that gets passed around at college on a roach clip, which I don't even think they use that term. They don't use that term anymore. Actually, someone said roach clip the other day, and I think the person in the audience thought I was going to talk about insect extermination. They had no idea what it was, but it was it's a relic of the 70s. But in reality, we're talking about things very, very different. We're talking about the dabs, which is what this is. These are 98%, some of it, potent THC. This has nothing to do with marijuana other than the THC. This has very little to do with most Americans, my parents' generation, experience with marijuana 20, 30 years ago. Very, very different than this. In fact, this really looks like heroin, if you were to ask anybody. In fact, when you don't label it and you ask someone what it is, they think it's heroin. Because, it's brown and sticky and very similar to certain kinds of heroin. This is not what you would consider marijuana. But this is one of the products that's now coming in. And then when you look over time, and the reason I think we do need to care, and people don't necessarily want to believe it, but it's important to go over the research because it is there, I think many of us are worried about long-term education and mental health impacts. This is the kind of drug, more than it affects, although it does affect your heart, absolutely, but more than these physical things, we worry about the mental, psychological, emotional kinds of effects. And so when the New Zealand study came out, it showed that if you were a kid that used marijuana semi-regularly for 3 years, you were significantly more likely than a kid who didn't use to lose 8 points on the IQ scale. Now, what does that mean? Well, if you're Steve Jobs, or you were any one of our last three presidents, maybe, 8 points isn't going to be a huge issue. If you're a genius or whatever, 8 points is not going to be something that you're going to miss. But if you're an average student, for example, here in Connecticut, your IQ is 100, not 150. You're not a genius. I know parents want to think everyone's a genius, but they're not. Not every kid can be a genius. That's why there's the average. It's 100. You lose 8 points on 100. That is the difference between graduating and not. That is the difference between getting the job you want versus the one you have to settle for. It does matter. It doesn't mean you're going to necessarily totally fail in life, but it means that you are going to be significantly hampered, and that 8 points can mean a lot. It actually translates to millions of dollars, by the way, in lifetime income potential. And so that's what's interesting is when you ask marijuana users later in life about their self-satisfaction, and these are people who are admittedly you're using marijuana, they are like significantly reporting lower quality of life. That doesn't mean that there aren't marijuana users that are smart, there aren't marijuana users that are really successful, there aren't marijuana users that are great at business or great at whatever. I'm not saying that there aren't. There are, just like there are, you know, functional heroin addicts that we would not know use heroin. There are people who have tried crack cocaine or methamphetamine. They were not a failure in life. There are people that drive 85 on a freeway and you know, get a few speeding tickets every 10 years but never get into a car crash. There are people who refuse to wear seatbelts. There are people who never will wear a bike helmet. There are plenty of those people, and they will not have those negative outcomes. But when you look at science, which is not looking at one person, I always have to remind people that the plural of anecdote is not data. And so when people say, but I know someone, and then I knew someone else, and I know five people who are really successful, use marijuana, that is not a scientific study. I hate to say it. That's your own experience, wonderful, but it comes with biases and all kinds of other things. And it comes with what you see, it comes with your perspective, it comes with your socioeconomic background that you hang out with. It comes with a lot of caveats. When you do science, you look at many people over a long period of time, you control for multiple factors. Because some people said, Kevin, maybe all those people in the marijuana group were also drinking. Maybe they came from broken homes. Maybe they had bad schooling. Maybe they just were generally not inclined to study. Not everybody is studious. The thing about science is you can control for those things. You can say, ah, you know what? We checked that. It wasn't the alcohol, which is what they did. Actually, this study was so controversial because it's so dramatic. I mean, if people really knew what 8 points among a general population is, that's a dramatic finding, especially in science when usually you're not finding anything that dramatic. You're sort of a little bit here, a little bit there. This was challenged by a number of people who said, this can't be right. Yeah, this is why you're probably wrong. And the researchers said, all right, well, we're going to do the study again, and we're going to do it in rats as well. So not just humans, but rats. Because one of the big criticisms was you didn't control for socioeconomic factors. And the researcher said, well, we did it in rats, and it showed the same thing. The rats didn't have a socioeconomic factor. We didn't get poor rats and rich rats and white rats and black rats. We didn't get, the rat is a rat. And so they respond to IQ tests as well. It showed the exact same thing. It doesn't mean I'm going to say this is definitive and we can never say it's going to change. It's not the law of gravity. But it was a very powerful study. Another powerful research area in this field has been mental illness, specifically short-term psychoses, and so like a panic attack, a psychotic episode, so to speak, and then long-term, which is probably one of the worst brain diseases you would never even wish on your worst enemy, and that's a long-term schizophrenia. And so what we're seeing is not a causation, because people say, how do you know what causes it? We don't. What we do see is a very strong correlation, even when controlling for things, when you talk about schizophrenia and psychoses. And you talk to mental health workers, you go look at the mental health data that's out there, you see that heavy marijuana use is a factor in many of those things. Now, some people say, well, Kevin, chicken before the egg. Was it they used marijuana to deal with their mental illness because it was sort of made them feel better? Or was it that the marijuana caused the mental illness? Well, the reality is that's very hard to know the direction. I don't think it's that important, though, that question, because all I know is that marijuana makes it worse. So if you have a mental illness, we know it makes it worse. And we also know that if you're genetically susceptible, and none of us know whether you're genetic, I mean, you know, you parents may not have had a mental illness, but you have no idea about your DNA on that factor with your ancestors. If you are predisposed to mental illness, we also know marijuana plays a bigger factor in terms of the role in triggering some of these problems. And we also know that what's so, I think, sinister and worrisome about marijuana is that it's a kind of tricky drug in that somebody with mental illness or PTSD, for example, and that was a big issue and I know still is, and a group of Yale researchers are actually working on it now. But the issue of PTSD, people say, well, marijuana makes me feel better and I don't have the nightmares anymore and I don't want to use these opiates, so I should use marijuana. First of all, they're making a false dichotomy between opiates and marijuana. The idea that those are the only two treatments, that medication is the only way for PTSD, or that these two medications are the only thing, I think is a false dichotomy. The second issue is, it's not surprising that those with PTSD would feel good when they're smoking marijuana in the short term. Because that's what it does. You don't necessarily have those nightmares when you're high, because you're not thinking about anything. And so in that way, it's like, well, at least you're not having your nightmares. Okay, that's good. But on the other hand, you are probably making your long-term mental illness worse because you're using it all the time, and in the short term you're feeling great. In the long term though, we think it can be very dangerous. There's also another thing is that I don't know if we want to necessarily have people high all the time on any drug as a way to manage any illness. You know, part of the problem with opiates, folks, is that they were never meant to be chronic, long-term pain management. So it's not surprising when, you know, my grandmother is prescribed, I don't know how much morphine, and is using it for 15 years for her chronic pain, that she doesn't feel any, that she still has pain. And the morphine's not doing anything anymore because the morphine should have been there for a year maximum, 6 months. But what's happening, and this is a big problem with the medical profession, is we've relied on opiates as a long-term pain management solution. And for a lot of people, not everybody, but for a lot of people, that does not work. You know, you see people with long-term pain on methadone. Methadone is never meant to be a long-term pain management strategy. It's just, it's gonna wear off. What? Why? Because your receptors get dulled. It's like if you ate pizza every day for a year, just think about that. The second year, do you think that that pizza is gonna do anything to you other than just make you feel sick? Are you gonna taste cheese anymore? No. Listen, I've been on a cruise, a one-week cruise. You can't feel food after the eighth day because they're eating so much. This is a part of the issue, you know. This is why buffets are really dangerous. Because you're just like, all the time, you don't feel your food anymore. I mean, really, that happens for those of you who've done that. It's the same thing with something like opiates. Your receptors are so dulled by it. And the same thing is with THC and marijuana after a while. That's why you see withdrawal from marijuana for so many people. It's like, well, I didn't think there was withdrawal. That's really for heroin and cocaine. How could you feel withdrawal? Of course you feel withdrawal because you have receptors in the brain that are there, and once you don't feel that, you feel very empty. And you just need it to feel normal, unfortunately, sometimes, after long-term drug use, and that's really when we get into chronic addiction. So anyway, back on the mental illness thing, I think this is something that we have to watch because we don't deal with mental illness very well in this country. It took our Congress 100 years to recognize the fact that, and you're gonna be so proud when I tell you this, that, you know, Patrick Kennedy, who helped found my organization, talks about the revolutionary idea to members of Congress that the brain is an actual part of the body. That's a revolutionary idea because we always thought of the brain as separate. You know, if you have a bad hip, a bad knee, I have tennis elbow, I'm playing too much tennis, my back hurts from my golf swing, you go to the doctor, my heart, my diabetes, you go to the doctor and they don't say to you, oh, well, you know, you are a very bad person because you have diabetes and therefore we're not going to treat you and we just don't want anything to do with you, go away. Or we don't say to them, you know, we don't treat that in the doctor's office. You need to get your diabetes treated way out there. We don't want to see it and go to the church basement. Don't talk about it. Shut up about it. That's how we've treated mental illness for 100 years. That's a brain disease. Something's going on in our brain. Now, it is somewhat different, and I'm the first to say that addiction and mental health, those are different than heart disease in one fundamental way. And that's actually what makes it even more urgent in my mind to treat it, because they affect other people in very fundamental ways. You know, if I have heart disease, you feel very bad for me, and that's a terrible thing. And especially if I don't have insurance, you might pay for it. And that way it affects you. But I'm probably not gonna break into your car to get money to buy a cheeseburger if I have high cholesterol or heart disease. I'm probably not gonna lie to my mom and steal from her in her wallet if I have diabetes because I wanna go get a Snickers bar. But with mental illness and addiction, you absolutely will do that. You absolutely will lie, you absolutely will commit crime, and you see all the crimes going on in this country and you combine so many different bad policies, including mental health, lack of mental health, and of course you see crime. You don't see crime among people with diabetes. It's different fundamentally, and it affects other people fundamentally in big, big ways. You know, every time I come to your state, I think of Sandy Hook. Every time, you know, we think about these mass, horrible atrocities, please do your own research. Research the drug abuse, and you'll be surprised to know which drug was used by many of these killers, unfortunately. And research the history of mental illness and the warning signs. And come to your own conclusions, but, you know, and I'm not saying causality or that's the only thing, but it's something that I don't think we can afford to ignore any longer. You know, also people talk about, is marijuana a gateway drug? I don't like the term gateway because it means that, you know, we're sort of saying that if you use marijuana, you're automatically going to use heroin, or it's like you're totally 100%. The reality is most people who use marijuana will never use heroin. That's true. Most people who use marijuana will never use cocaine. Actually, most people who try marijuana don't like it, is the big secret. It's funny. We should advertise that more often to young people. Most people, they don't like it at all. They use it one or two times and it's just not for them. But then other people, obviously, it is for them. But they don't necessarily go on to use heroin for sure. However, if you look at the heroin addicts in this country, 92% of them, marijuana was their first drug of choice. So it depends on how you want to look at this. By the way, that is a stronger correlation than painkillers to heroin. And people say the only way people are starting heroin is because they're on opiates. Half the people it is. But for a lot of other people, marijuana was actually the first drug. Why is that, you might be thinking? Because the more interesting question is why, not does it happen? Yeah, it happens, but why does it happen? There are a lot of theories about it. One theory that's starting is more of a biological theory, saying that essentially marijuana essentially doesn't get you as high as you want to get after a while. And your brain says, okay, you've gone this far with THC, we need to step it up a little. And so when you look at rodent studies, which is a good sort of beginning before you do the human trials, of marijuana and heroin, you see some very interesting connections. You see, for example, adolescents exposed to THC, you know, in your teenage years, seem to translate into adults seeking heroin more avidly, strongly, more rapidly, they more intensely, essentially is what that means. If you're exposed to THC in utero, when your mom is pregnant, the adult offspring seek heroin more avidly, and there are bigger behavioral issues and brain impairment with those kids. And by the way, any of you saw 60 Minutes on Sunday, you saw the report on the babies that are being born with high levels of THC in their body. We have no idea what that does because we've barely studied it, but I have a feeling it's not good. The early studies in rats say that it's very bad. Future parents exposed to THC long before pregnancy, even before pregnancy, you're seeing adult offspring seeking heroin more compulsively and more heroin withdrawal. So those people that are on heroin, if you take two people on heroin, the one whose parent actually was using a lot of marijuana before seemed to have worse withdrawal, brain, and behavioral changes. These are early studies. This is a study, though, published by 15 people in the most prominent neuropsychopharmacological journal in the world. That doesn't mean it's a gospel. It just means we need to wait and see what happens. But it's early data that I think we need to look at. There's also a very good twin study saying that the twin who used marijuana before age 17 was 4.5 times more likely to use heroin later in life, even when controlling for other things. So look, this is early. We need to look at it. But I don't understand why we are talking about the heroin epidemic and totally ignoring the marijuana issue. We're talking about an industry, pharma, which absolutely addicted millions of people because they wanted to get rich. Let's be very clear, that's exactly what they did. The idea that we want another industry to do that shows me that our ability to regulate industries is very bad. Our ability to rein in a company selling something addictive is very poor. And if it's poor with pharma and everything else, alcohol, tobacco, I don't get why we think we're going to be different with marijuana. That for some reason this time marijuana is going to be different, I don't understand. When it's not marijuana, but it's the THC products that are coming in all different shapes and colors, it's obvious who they're targeting. It's very obvious who they're targeting. You know, the baby boomer who used marijuana last time in 1975 is not exactly the target for juicy green apple flavored THC bars. That's obviously to make it attractive to young people in the adolescent brain. Now, these are the gummy bears and the gummy worms. The state of Colorado now is so proud of themselves. They said, well, okay, 3 year, you know, we are so good. 3 years after we allowed this on the market, we've now changed our policy. So you can't have gummies in the shape of animals anymore. That's the big change. That's what we should be happy about. Oh, and then they said, in every edible, we've put a warning on it. And we said, okay, well, is the warning a stop sign? Is the warning like danger? What is the warning? Because people are going to the emergency room. The warning is a diamond that says THC. That's supposed to stop the five-year-old from knowing what's a chocolate, real chocolate, what's a pot chocolate. That's supposed to stop anybody. It's a joke, folks. And it's because there's a massive industry who is very, very powerful in that state. People talk about the money. It'll solve our budgetary problems. I asked this question last time I was here, but the lottery is still here in Connecticut? Oh, okay. So now I asked this last time, and you said it hadn't worked yet. But now, 2 years later, are you top education in the Northeast now? Has that been the big boon for the economy? Are you flush with cash? You don't know what to do with the money you have? Okay. At the very least, do you have free addiction treatment for those addicted to gambling? How about free addiction treatment for those for alcoholics? Because you have an alcohol tax, right? There's some kind of alcohol tax. Okay. So you're not even able to provide the treatment for alcoholics. What about treatment for tobacco addicts? I didn't think so. And don't worry, I'm not making you feel bad. You're the same as every other state. You know, dangling money in front of people saying, we're going to pay for your new school. We're going to pay for treatment. Let's stop giving the money to drug dealers. Well, unfortunately, the drug dealers in Colorado, for example, are still there. They're actually there. They've undercut the legal price. So they're competing with the legal market. So you not only have the drug dealers like you had before, but now you have the advertisements, the TV, the billboard, the radio, the normalization. You have them. They're sort of doing the work for the drug dealer. They're advertising. Because you're going to see how great it is, and then you're going to go to the store and say, ooh, that's expensive. I'm going to go to the guy you always went to. You have the worst of both worlds. People say, well, we can get rid of the black market. You don't. You keep it. It thrives. And you don't pay for anything. Alcohol, even the New York Times, which unfortunately came out with a big editorial last year in favor of legalization, although if anybody caught the Wall Street Journal yesterday, you saw the big editorial against legalization, which was very good. But the New York Times said, well, it's time to do it. It's a social justice issue. We need money for school. Even they then admitted that actually it won't save state budgets. Whoops. No, it won't. Why pot taxes can't solve Colorado's budget problem was an op-ed in the Denver Post by a nonpartisan think tank studying economics in that state. And we shouldn't be surprised. Look at our national picture on alcohol and tobacco. For every dollar in alcohol tax, it costs us almost 20 in social costs. For every dollar in tobacco, it costs us 10 in social costs. So we're not paying for alcohol treatment here because you're paying for drunk drivers. You're not paying for tobacco treatment because you're paying for the guy who doesn't have insurance or insurance can't cover the lung cancer bill. You're also not paying for it because the companies are paying for it with lost productivity and issues at the workplace. So that's why we're not able to pay for any of this. And yet we're always told, well, it'll help schools and it'll help all these things, and that's why you should vote for it. I do want to talk very briefly about Colorado and Washington. And we actually have some brand new data that from literally 2 days ago that's not yet on a PowerPoint. But it is important to know that Colorado, for example, did not legalize marijuana overnight. Right? This was something that happened over time with medical marijuana, decriminalization, and then finally recreational stores open. And this is what your average marijuana store looks like. Now, I don't know about you, but what the malls are like here, but this looks like a mall where I grew up. Candy store is what it looks like. It doesn't look like marijuana. If you were to ask somebody, what is this? I don't think they would say marijuana. Right? If you were to ask like an average person who's used marijuana like 30 years ago, they wouldn't say this was marijuana, but this is exactly what it looks like. And so I think you have five big problems with it. First of all, you have the kid-friendly stuff, which they're, okay, now you can't do a gummy bear, but you can do everything else. 95% potent with these concentrates. Aggressive marketing. They're offering free samples, gift bags, billboards, other tactics very similar to tobacco. By the way, there's also contaminants. And we were told if you regulate it, then it won't have the contaminants in it that are often lacing today's street marijuana. Well, actually, they have had to recall 60 individual products. That is equivalent to 200,000 packages because of pesticides, additives, things you can't even put in paint thinner that they're finding. And their answer, by the way, when I asked the Department of Taxation and Regulation, they say, oh, isn't it great? We're regulating it. Now, we only know about that because we're actually regulating it. Otherwise, Kevin, we wouldn't even know about it. Well, no, I think it's more like, what are we not seeing? I mean, you caught 60, But if there's 60, I bet you there's 60 more because they're totally understaffed, of course. And so they're not able to deal with it. And then you have a massive industry fighting regulation. They have lobbied against warning labels, dosing rules. They wanted to say, let's put dosing rules on it. No. How about warnings with a stop sign? No. The gummy bear thing was only because of a lot of outside pressure. And they said, okay, we won't do animals. But we're still going to do other things. And that was the big victory. One thing that I think is fascinating, too, is we were told that young people would be arrested fewer times. Actually, interestingly enough, the arrest rate for young people for pot in Colorado has gone up. And that has disproportionately gone up among blacks and Hispanics. Now, people say, how could that happen? It's legal. Well, it's not legal if you're under 21. Kids don't know that, by the way. How are we doing with alcohol? I mean, I don't think they've gotten the memo that it's illegal for them. They're still using it. They bring it to school. They think if it's legal for adults, they think it's legal for them. They bring it to school. They bring it to campuses. DUI, public intoxication. All of these are still arrestable offenses. So actually, you need more law enforcement, not less. And although there's been a decrease in sort of simple possession arrests, yes, there's been a big increase in young people being arrested. And this was at least supposed to be one of the reasons why we said, okay, we might have increased use, but maybe we'll have decreased arrests. I want to show you, and it's from our website, our new report. And that report essentially found that Colorado is now the number one, it's like we're having some problems here, but that's okay, the number one youth state in the country for marijuana use for the first time. It's also showing, oh, here we go. It's also showing a very, very big increase in hospital admissions because of these poisonings that are happening. So on our website is learnaboutsam.org. You'll see this report. I encourage you to download it, send it around, send it to your legislators and others. It's literally hot off the press, like 2 days old. But essentially, it goes through the experience. It shows that here's all the states with medical and legalization. Colorado is number one. Here's, let's see, where are you guys? You guys are here, 8.5%. Colorado's number one in the country. The other legal states aren't far behind. It's now the number one use rate. Regular marijuana use has gone up in Washington as well. We talk about the black market. The Attorney General of Colorado, the state that is defending what they're doing, has said the criminals are still selling on the black market. We have plenty of cartel activity in Colorado and plenty of illegal activity that has not decreased at all. And that's from their Attorney General. We're talking about the link to homelessness. If you've been, anyone been to Denver lately? The downtown 16th Street Mall is a place you used to want to go to. You don't really want to hang out there anymore. Because of the smell, first of all, the reeking smell of marijuana everywhere, but the huge influx of, and it's really sad, young runaways who see Colorado as the promised land now. They've had a massive increase in homelessness. And another big increase in workplace drug tests. And this is an area where people don't think about businesses and the workforce, but because marijuana stays in your system, it's not like alcohol. You know, if you were drunk last night, we probably couldn't tell today. Because alcohol is in and out of your system. Marijuana stays in your system for sometimes up to 30 days, usually about 2 weeks, because it binds to your fat. THC is lipid where it sticks. That's where it goes. And so when you test for it, it's there for a while. And we have seen increases in workforce accidents, liability, all kinds of things. And I don't care if it's legal or not. If you're using marijuana, good luck with getting a job and passing the drug test. I mean, that, you know, whether it's legal or not. And yet, that is something that we don't talk about that often. There's been a, as we talked about, the impact on communities of color. You know, what's amazing is if you look at where the marijuana stores are in Denver, they're clustered, these dots here. They're clustered here. What kind of neighborhoods do you think these are? They're poorer neighborhoods. Mainly communities of color. And we shouldn't be surprised, folks. Where are the alcohol outlets in our country? Right? Where are the liquor stores? I'm going to tell you, I was just in LA. They're not in Beverly Hills. They're not in Bel Air. They're in Compton, though. We were also in Compton. And we had a rally in Compton, and the leaders in Compton said, I know we're known for gang activity and drugs, but they said, we haven't had a new school here built in 20 years. You want to build a pot shop? Forget about it. Now, what's amazing is that, and I don't know if there are any elected officials here, you might think that legalization is the issue of the day and everyone's in favor and all that. You start talking to local residents, whether they voted for it or not, they might be in favor of legalization as a general idea. But then you ask them if they want a pot shop in their community, the answer is always no. Nobody wants one there because it contributes to community decay. Nobody wants a secondhand smoke. Folks, it took us 100 years to kick out the tobacco industry from restaurants. Now in Denver next week, they're voting on allowing marijuana smoking in certain restaurants. They haven't had smoking in restaurants in 40 years. In California, they're voting on legalization there. That would allow advertising on television. We haven't seen a TV ad for tobacco since 1971 in this country. And that initiative, hidden in the fine print, never discussed by the pro side. They've spent $20 million, by the way, on their campaign. We've only raised $1 million, so 20 to 1. They talk about regulation and safer. They never mentioned that it would legalize this. In fact, they deny it, even though a judge said, actually, the way you wrote it, it does allow radio and TV ads. And so, anyway, when you look at who it's targeting, it's very, very clear where these are concentrated and who they're targeting. Anyway, I would suggest driving while high is a huge issue. There has been a massive increase in car crashes in both Washington and Colorado for DUI cases with marijuana because marijuana slows your reaction time and your reflexes. It slows your ability to judge distance. If you've seen anyone who's high, it's kind of obvious they're not exactly having the best reflexes in the world. They're not the fastest people when they're intoxicated. Imagine what the driving does. So that has been a big issue. And you combine marijuana with alcohol, and you see a big, big increase in car crashes as well. I had a kid the other day say, Kevin, I thought smoking pot and drinking it cancel each other out. Because, you know, smoking pot makes me kind of dopey, and alcohol makes me kind of, no, it makes it worse, actually. It increases the chance more than drinking alone and more than pot alone when you combine the two together. I think we have to be very, very cautious there. Anyway, you can go check out the rest of the report. We talk about edibles. We talk about the crime issue, which we talk about empty promises with tax revenue, suicide. Obviously, we need more data, but we don't. The state is not really collecting the data. We have to kind of find it ourselves, which is very unfortunate because they're not. I mean, you know, that's the last thing you want to do if you're at a state that has to support this is show that it's not going well. That's not going to be good for you. So that's those issues. And then I want to end with the landscape in 5 days. We have multiple states voting on ballots, California, Nevada, Arizona, Massachusetts, and Maine. I've touched on some of the issues, but I want to touch on a couple more. In Arizona, for example, hidden in the law, if it passes there, which is called Prop 205, hidden in Prop 205 is a provision that says we're going to have a marijuana commission. The commission is going to make the rules about what marijuana legalization looks like. And by the way, 3 of the 7 members on the commission have to be owners, directors, or managers of pot businesses. That's like letting Philip Morris in charge of tobacco policy. It's crazy. But again, you're not hearing that in the campaign. It's the last thing they want to emphasize. But folks, this is the industry writing the rules. That's what this is about. And some people say, well, you know, can't we have state licensed stores or do it a little bit better? They're the ones writing the rules. And they're going to write the rules in the way that maximizes their profit. In Massachusetts, 9 of the 15 members will be industry controlled in their advisory board. In California, very limited local control. It also allows pot bars to operate. So it's like, indoor smoking again. And it also establishes an advisory committee with industry representatives. It makes all product safety and testing standards voluntary. And if there are going to be any standards, industry makes those standards. It allows, as I said, the advertising, the billboards, the event sponsorships, the coupons, television, radio. In Nevada, this is the kicker. This is the one that I couldn't believe. This is a law to legalize marijuana, remember, in Nevada. If you grow your own marijuana and you live within 25 miles of a pot shop, you can be considered a criminal. That's for legalization. Why is that? Because guess who wrote the law in Nevada? The alcohol industry and the medical marijuana industry. And they struck a deal. The alcohol wholesalers get first-to-market advantage in obtaining a license to distribute marijuana. The alcohol wholesalers. The medical marijuana business gets first-to-market for retail. And they came to an agreement that they didn't want people growing their own pot because, you know, how do they make money if that happens? You will be a criminal if you grow marijuana and you live in Vegas, Reno, any of the major cities. So folks, this isn't even about smoking marijuana. I mean, we can have a discussion about whether that's good or not, but this is not even about that. This is about money. It's about making money. It's about an industry making money. And I don't think the average Nevada voter knows about this. All of the initiatives allow edibles and concentrates. And there's a lot more to it. But if you want to go to our website, it's learnaboutsam.org. My email is there. I do want to thank John Davio there in the back for heading up our Connecticut SAM affiliate. We're going to be a lot more active in 2017 in the legislature, and we are always looking for more volunteers, for speakers, and it doesn't matter if you're new to this, if you're somewhat interested in this, we are trying to build a bigger movement. We don't have the money that the pro side has. We don't have the industry money. By the way, we are not funded with a penny from pharmaceutical companies, obviously alcohol, tobacco, anything like that. We're all volunteer-driven. Voluntary contributions. If you happen to know any billionaires, please put me in touch. Because the other side has about four, so I just want one. So if you know one, let us know. But you know, in reality, I realize this is a David and Goliath fight, but I also realize there's a lot that we can do. Most people don't want a marijuana store in their community. Most people do not want pot gummy bears. Most people do not want marijuana drivers on the road. Most people know that the tax money is not going to actually go to schools when you start to talk about the actual experience. So we need more troops. We need more people talking about this, interested in sharing their own stories and being part of our team. So I know it's gotten later than we wanted, but that is the website. That is my email. If you have questions, already there are a few. Sure. Okay, great. Okay. Is there any funded study to research other components of marijuana in the U.S.? That's a great question, because people think that because it's illegal, you can't study it, which is not what this person's saying, but a lot of people think that. You can study it. Actually, there are hundreds of researchers today with a license from the DEA to study the other components in marijuana, and about 1,000 children are receiving, and we have a picture of it, might as well show you, a component of marijuana called CBD, CBD oil. They're receiving what we call Epidiolex. Epidiolex is from a UK company that has made this. And Epidiolex is purified CBD oil for kids with seizures. The trials are going well, and that's something we would definitely support. That's very different than, you know, pot gummy bears. We've got to separate the issue. The legalization groups love to combine these issues, because if they're able to say to a reasonable person, don't you want a kid to get this? You're going to say, yeah, I mean, if it's good for them, okay, then we should legalize marijuana. They sort of go from that to this big leap and hope that no one notices. But you know, it's important to separate the issues, and it is very important to do the research. And I think there's going to be more research going on as well. The DEA recently lifted some rules about growing marijuana if you're a research entity like a university, so I think that's going to happen. Is there substantial data to support mental health as a condition to self-medicate with marijuana? And can we get a copy of the slides? You can definitely get a copy of the slides. There are actually, these slides and more are on our website, which I'll put, again, are at the end, Learn About Sam. I'll just put it there so that people see it. Is there substantial data to support the mental health as a condition to self-medicate? There isn't. I mean, the data doesn't show that marijuana is good for mental health. People say that it may help them, like people on PTSD. And again, I think that's because we're looking at a much more short-term view. I think when you look at the data, the majority of the data really focus on it being a risk factor. And marijuana use, especially heavy use, high THC marijuana, even worse than low THC, being a risk factor for marijuana. In states where marijuana is legal, can businesses not hire? Businesses, even if it's legal, you can prevent that. The problem is not so much businesses aren't able to say, we're not going to hire you. The problem is more getting a pool of employees that are good to hire. And so the largest construction company in Colorado has for the first time hired out of the state. because they can't get a construction worker to pass a marijuana test or enough of them. So the pool of hires is smaller. So if you're drug free, by the way, in a legalized environment, you're a hot commodity because it's harder. You're harder to get. What is Sam? Let's see. What is Sam's socio or political legal policy recommendations for managing marijuana? I'm not sure I understand the question. I think maybe this means what do we want to see policy-wise? We want to see policies that don't criminalize people, but also focus on education and awareness. Look, if we had a marijuana campaign, awareness campaign for parents, by the way, not just kids. I mean, parents seem to be as educated as kids, frankly. If we had a campaign a fourth of what the tobacco, anti-tobacco campaign has been, I'll take it. Because right now we have nothing. The National Youth Anti-Drug Media Campaign that we used to have in the 90s and 2000s and 80s, late 80s, has been totally zeroed out by Congress. We have a Truth Initiative for Smoking, which is wonderful, and they're great people, and we work with them. But for marijuana, there's a big void. And instead, filling the void are celebrities, websites, and big money trying to convince kids that this is totally harmless. And I think there needs to be something to counter that, not in a reefer madness kind of way, but in a way that emphasizes the science, but I think also emphasizes, you know, your future. Because, you know, parents are spending more today on their kids' college preparation than they ever have before. We're spending more money on job training. We're spending more money on all of these things. The idea that we wouldn't realize that marijuana runs counter to that doesn't make any sense. We need to bring up these other issues, I think, that are very, very salient. So we have a couple more. Sure. Any celebrities on this side of the issue? Well, we need more. I think there have been a few. I mean, yes, look, there are a lot of drug-free celebrities. I mean, you know, Katy Perry, I know, came out last year and said she does not smoke marijuana. It's really not for her. She doesn't like it. That helps. But unfortunately, it's countered by a lot of other folks that are in favor. There are others that, of course, I'm not thinking about now, but we definitely need more. The problem with celebrities is, you know, it's difficult because they're in a totally different world. And, you know, you could have a celebrity on your side, and then if they do something stupid, related or not related to marijuana or drugs, you've lost a lot of credibility. So I think it's like high reward, but also very high risk. The issue with the other side is if you're pro-marijuana and you have a celebrity on your side, you know, it's not a bad thing if they do something stupid. It's kind of like part of the brand. So they have less to lose. It's like, you know, you sort of expect, I mean, I don't know if there are any Lindsay Lohan fans in here or whatever, but you sort of, or Miley, you expect these people to sort of just kind of do things that are goofy and dumb and irreverent. And it's kind of like, oh yeah, well, they love pots. So of course they did. But they have less to lose when that happens. We have a lot more to lose. So I think it's a double-edged sword. If tax money doesn't cover the expenses, why do those claims continue? Because, I mean, the ignorance is widespread, and it costs money to get your messages out. This is why I was half serious when I said, if you know a billionaire, because it costs money. Listen, they have been saying for 40 years, marijuana is medicine and it's safer than alcohol. That's all they said. And now they're about to legalize marijuana. They legalized marijuana for the first time 4 years ago. They've been trying for 40 or more. So it takes time to get your messages through. Unfortunately, the average person just thinks, yeah, it's going to drug dealers, so why can't it come to government? Thank you all for coming today, and I really appreciate being your guest. Thank you.